We are going to pray as we have said the scriptures this Sunday. Welcome to church and welcome to the month of April. The Lord be with you in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Father, we ask you that you will teach us by your Spirit and you will explain the scriptures to us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Last week we had a look at our said scriptures and that teaches us about our civic responsibilities as Christians, our responsibilities to one another, to the church, and to the world, and to government of our various nations. Today's study, we're looking at love and submission in the home. Love and submission in the home. And our text is found in the book of 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through to 7. But let's look at a memory verse, which actually is in verses 5 and 6, which says, verse 5, "For after this manner, in the old time, the old women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement." 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Again, the topic we are considering in our search of scriptures this morning is love and submission in the home. And this talk about the relationship of husband and wife. Of course, somebody might be looking at this and says, "Thank God this study is not for me because I am not yet married." Well, the study is for you. As you listen, God will bless you because the unmarried person today is going to be married tomorrow and is going to get married tomorrow. And besides that, we know that the lessons we learn helps us to understand that we have a bridegroom and we are the bride of the bridegroom. We are the wives of the Lord and Jesus Christ is the husband of the church. And therefore, the lessons we learn helps us in our relationship towards our Lord Jesus Christ and towards one another in the various families. Now, the Apostle Peter shifted his attention from talking about civil responsibilities to the family, what should permeate in the family of believers. He wants us to know that as soon as we become Christians, children of God, our Christian experience also must percolate into our family. People must see Christ in us. We must know that as children of God, we have responsibilities towards one another. And even though before we got converted, it might happen that we have not been converted before we got married. But after marriage, we have responsibilities towards our husbands and towards our wives. And every one of us will have responsibility towards Christ. And there are two key words that helps in family, bringing stability, bringing progress into the home. Number one is submission. Number two is love. And these twin pillars stands out as a sure solution, panacea to the survival of our homes and families. And then the manifestation of holiness between husband and wife begins at home. And it has a ripple effect of winning the unbelievers back unto our God. When the people behold our love, our submission, our chaste behavior in the families, unbelievers will come to identify with our God and they want to serve him also. But Apostle Paul, Peter also went ahead to mention the issue of holy adornment, which has permeated our society today. But the believer's life is a life of sobriety. We are sober in disposition, we are sober in appearance, and that is why as we look at this story today, we see the gain, the benefit that we have as we obey Christ in the areas of submission and love in the family, and the area of living modest life as God himself has called us to live. If we do this, number one, our home will be like heaven on earth. We can find righteousness in the families, peace, joy, fellowship, comfort, rest, respect for one another, fruitfulness, if we sincerely obey the scripture commands that we wives should love our husbands, and then we husbands should, and we wives should submit to our husbands, and we husbands should love our wives. And all of us together, we should submit to the authority of Christ, who is the husband of the church. As we do that, the Lord bless us in Jesus' name. Now, three things we look at in our study scriptures this morning, that we start with need for submission in the Christian home. Need for submission in the Christian home. I read the book of 1 Peter, chapter 3, in verse 1. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. And then in chapter 2, let's look at verse 6 of the same place we are reading now. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. Now, when we look at the Christian family, we find the wife, the husband, the children, and maybe they have people living around them as witnesses. We must understand that it's a commandment of the Lord that the wife should submit to the husband in the homes. If we are going to keep the institution of marriage sacred, if we are going to make the fear of God to permeate in our families, if we are going to enjoy our relationship as families, we are commanded as wives to submit ourselves unto our husband. The Bible even says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 and 25, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, also love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Now, how did Christ love the church? He gave himself for it. He sacrificed his life for it. And then he came to make himself example, a model for the church. The same way, we wives are called upon to submit unto our husband, and we husbands are called upon to love our wives. The Bible says, let the wife be subject unto the husbands in everything, financial matters, family matters, the matters of the health of the children, and in everything we do in family. The husband has the final say, as Christ has the final say over the affairs of the church. No Christian, true child of God, a disciple of Christ, want to argue with Jesus Christ on matters that are clear in the scriptures, want to obey him. If he talks to us about distancing ourselves from worldliness, we do that. When he talks to us about our comportment to the outside world, we obey that. When he talks to us about cross-bearing and carrying our cross and following him, we obey that. Whatever Jesus says is the final in the life of every believer. The same way Christian wives should have understanding that when they submit to their own husbands, they are submitting to God and submitting to the will of God. Our deeds and our actions in the home, and it must be in relation to the way we submit unto Christ, who is our ultimate leader and captain. So then, we are supposed to be instruments of peace in our families. When our mouth is not under control, when we discuss on matters that affect the progress of the family, remember that united we stand, in family divided we fall. If the family is going to progress, we have to understand the issue of submissiveness and the issue of love. And the Bible tells us in Colossians 3, verses 17 and 23, and whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. When wives allow this understanding to guide them, it will not be difficult for them to submit to the headship of their husbands. And we're told that in verse 1 of this first Peter, it says, likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, that is, some of them are yet be unconverted, some of them are still be children of the enemy, and we are praying for them to be converted, to become children of God. But they may also, by your conversation, by your lifestyle, be won to the Lord, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. Your life may sanctify the unbelieving husband. The same way, the life of the husband is sanctified, may bring sanity, may bring, you know, the fear of God into the life of the unconverted wife. So we see how Apostle Peter was addressing this issue in this book of 1 Peter chapter 3. We are living in the society, we're living in the world of civilization, where many things are changing very rapidly. And there are some societies where women are given very little regard, and the husbands treat the women more or less like slaves. And then the women have no voice at all. It is shut down, shut up all the time. And God is not happy with that. We are all heirs of the grace of God. But again, when matters come in the family that needs understanding, the husband must be given the final say, as Christ has the final say over the affairs of the church. We must understand that we are being called upon to peace and nothing but peace. Then the apostle was trying to tell us that the woman should submit to her own husband in particular. There are many women that can submit to the husbands of other women outside. They submit to their bosses at work, but when it comes to their house, to the home, it is difficult for them to submit to their own husbands. This is not right. Christian women should understand that they are godly and they must portray the godliness that they profess. The moment we have come to know Christ, we have a divine authority over us. Christ is the final authority, but in the home, the husband has the final say in matters that affect the wife and the family. Therefore, it's not a matter of male domination nor inferiority of the female gender. It's a matter of significant role that God himself has appointed for the wife in the family. By fulfilling this role, a believing wife can influence her husband and children positively for the Lord. Remember, in many families today, that many children are not living happily because they see the rancor, they see the disagreement, they see the friction all the time. We must understand that we must give our children good education. At the same time, we must let them see the fear of God in our lives. And how we relate together must encourage our children when they are grown up to be eager to marry, and not to say, if marriage is like this, I will never go into marriage. As believers, we must understand that our obedience to the word of God can encourage even the unsaved souls to come to the saving knowledge of our Lord. Don't forget that our life is a book that people read every day. We must allow them to see the light of the gospel through us by living holily and righteously. Now, godly women should emulate Sarah. We have the example here that Sarah obeyed her husband, even calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. That's what we are told in verse 6 of 1 Peter chapter 3. Now, this appellation, Lord, reveals the kind of respect that Sarah had for her husband. And then we see that how she acknowledged that her husband was a superior and that he had the right to rule in his own house. Of course, the husband also must not be a boss in the family or a dictator in any matter. They can reason with the wife. They can plan together. They can pray together. Because all of us together have responsibility towards one another. That's why there are times we submit to one another. We submit to her views, and she submits to the views of the man also. But Sarah was calling her husband Lord. That's very much unlike the society of today. When the women of today, they call their husband by her first name, and they just give it to him right there. And if the husband is saying one, they say five. If the husband says two, they say ten. And this, they say, we are equal. All hairs are equal. What a man can do, a woman can do. And sometimes they even say they can do better. And then women are forming women liberation movement. And then they want to compete, they want to equate themselves with the men, or even say they are better than men. We are contradicting the scripture. The Bible says, wives, submit yourself to your own husbands as we submit unto the Lord. If you submit to the lordship of Jesus Christ and we don't submit to our husbands at all, it is still not complete. The woman should recognize that it is her duty to be in subjection to the head of the family. Christian wives should reverence and honor their husband, irrespective of your society, your status in the society. You may be a manager in that place of work, and your husband is the messenger. In the place of work, you are the boss, but when you get home, you are the subordinate. You must submit to the man. He is the owner of his own house. It might be that you are the director at your place of work. Your salary might be bigger than the salary of the husband. Your status position in society may be greater than that of the husband. But we recognize that God has set these things so. Adam was first formed before Eve came to know Adam. When we do this, we are bringing peace, we are bringing progress to our respective families. And the Lord will help you in Jesus' name. The second part of our study is not just of biblical adornment and sobriety. Not just of biblical adornment and sobriety. In 1 Peter chapter 3, looking at verses 3 to 5. Now, let's look at what it says. It says, whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair, of wearing of gold, and of putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which in the sight of God is of great price. Here the Apostle Peter explicates on the distinctiveness of godly women in contrast to the ungodly counterpart. You know, the adorning of the women professing godliness should be moderate and simple, not extravagant, not flamboyant. It should be devoid of all forms of worldly ornaments and all those noise that are coming up in the bodies of wedding women today. It must be a reflection of outward and inward disposition of sobriety, meekness, and a quiet spirit. The Bible says in the book of 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, that in like manner also that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but that which becomes women professing godliness with good works. What is the apostle telling us here? He was emphasizing modesty of the Christian wife. The Christian wife should avoid overdressing or due concentration on outward beauty. Women need to understand that what secures the love of the husband is not our cosmetics and the volume of ornament that we use to decorate ourselves. It is the beauty of the heart. Somebody may not be beautiful outward, but the beauty, the inner beauty, the meekness, the quiet spirit, this is what is attractive to our husband. We must be sure that our life radiates peace and beauty of Christ, that the people will see, our husband also will see. Go and study Proverbs chapter 31 and see how a virtuous woman display a virtue. The husband, the heart of the husband must surely be glad at her, and he must respect her because he was a woman of great value. In the sight of God, when we understand that God wants us to live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world, we would de-emphasize all the attachments that we put on our physical bodies and let our spiritual life be the reflection of Christ that we have professed to have. When we understand that Christ has called us into the life of peace and beauty, we must see it's not the beauty that is outward, but it's the inward beauty. Remember, there was a woman in the Bible called Jezebel that decorated herself so much, but she was the same person that destroyed her husband. It's not the outward, it was not the outward beauty that really matters, but the inward beauty. Of course, we Christian women can be neat, can be decent, presentable, because there are two ways that people follow today. There are those who believe that they have to go to the extreme way of making everything external. The adornment is that of the chains, of the earrings, of the hairdo, and all those things that are actually of vanity. But at the end of the day, the beauty of Christian life is missing in such people. The kind of comportment and meekness and holiness and meekness of Sarah is not found in their lives. But that is the other extreme of some other women that believe that to be a Christian woman is to be shabby and to dress unpresentably, and a woman at 35 is looking like 98. No, that is not also right. We have to maintain the middle road of a middle road policy by ensuring that we live a life that makes our husband happy all the time. There is no reason why your husband should be looking outside if you also make yourself presentable inside. The same way, we who are children of God must present ourselves neatly, modestly, and not extravagantly. Remember, the apostle warns us in Philippians that let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. However, the teaching on the priority of inner beauty should not be used as an excuse for a drab and repulsive outward appearance. A believer can do without all these makeups and all these external things. But again, we must understand that we must be presentable to God. The teaching is not saying that Christians should come to church with bathroom slippers, or you come to church with tattered dress, or you look for the rag in the house, and that's what you wear inside because you want to be humble. There is a difference between humility and holy, between humility and hypocrisy. The way we present ourselves before God also matters before God. Let us be neat, let us be presentable, let our appearance be that of moderation, the one that is becoming those professing godliness and holiness. The latter part of this story is the necessity of love and consideration by the husband. And I want to look at verse 7 of this 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, reading verse 7. It says, in verse 7, likewise, ye husband, dwell with them according to knowledge, given honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and has been heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Can you understand that word? That your prayers be not hindered. God wants us to understand as men that your prayers could be affected if the love that is expected in the home is missing. Love fulfills the divine plan of creation and redemption. In the family, it brings and builds fellowship, builds forgiveness, builds gentleness, builds unity, builds hope, builds peace, builds support, transformation, progress, freedom to pursue a worthy goal and desire for heaven. If we love our women at home, we are simply loving ourselves, because Ephesians 5 says that he that loveth his wife loveth himself. Love makes us to think of the future and the purpose for which we exist in the family. Love makes us want to help others fulfill their purpose and existence. There is nothing wrong in a man supporting the wife in the kitchen. There is nothing wrong with a man assisting the wife to carry some heavy load. But in some societies of today where the women are treated as slaves and they are not given opportunity at all, that is not Christianly. God commands us to love with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our bodies. As we love God, we also love our spouses. This is the command of the Lord. And the Bible says that if we do that, our prayers will not be hindered. I want you to understand that if the reason why you have been praying and praying and praying and you don't find answer is because you are not treating your wife as a friend, but you are treating your wife as somebody who is a stranger in the home. You are couples, but you live as co-tenants. And then you live like cat and rat. That is not good enough. True love radiates, and when found in the home, the husband accepts the wife the way she is in all situations. You marry that woman, no matter how old the woman has become. Now remember, you started together in love and togetherness and unity. Remember that in those days you saw her, that she was the angel of your life, and she was the sugar of your tea. But now, how now that she has now become a cow of Bashan, that you now begin to rebuke her, and then you look at her, you are looking at a witch now. How come that you now look at your husband, and you are looking at your husband, and you say, the same husband that you used to see beauty, and you are calling him the Adonis of mankind, but now he has become a bald-headed man that is now having a protruded belly, and you now see he is now ugly like a pig. When you begin to say some, unbecoming words to your wife or to your husband, you remember you are provoking and grieving the spirit. But we must allow freedom of relationship together. We must not give room to much offenses. We must understand when you are sanctified, these are the things you are sanctified from. Your heart is pure. The language of your mouth also must be pure. Our life must portray the life of peace. And Hebrews 12 verse 14 says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. If we are following peace in the family, between ourselves and our wives, between ourselves and our husbands, I can see that children in that family will grow up in the atmosphere of love. They will love God, they will also love human beings around them. But when Christian husbands possess this indispensable experience of love, they will certainly love and cherish their wives, despite the shortcomings of the wife. Nobody marries angel, but we bear and we forbear. In honor, we prefer one another. Observe the scripture that describes the wife as weaker vessels. The Bible calls them weaker vessels. He also calls them heirs together of the grace of life. The husband should be considerate and loving. We must cherish, we must nourish, we must protect and pray for the wife as Christ does for the church. Being bitter against one's wife and dishonoring her, especially in public, will lead to delay in answer to prayers. We can do open honor and a secret private correction. But we can commend in the open and correct in the privacy. That will make us to feel honor, feel loved among ourselves. Despite many causes of conflicts in the home, such as failure of partners to live and clean, delay in childbearing, worldliness, extravagance, carnal comparison, money management, because there are people that cannot share money matter together. The husband keeps his own account, the wife does not know about it. The wife is keeping her own account, the husband will never know how much she has in her account. These things are not good. We are together. We are married together. Our money also is married together. Together. And whatever we have, your property, your life, even your physical body. That's why we must not deny and must not deprive one another of anything that we have. We must understand that spending together and whatever happens, we must do it together. In sickness, we are together. In poverty, we are together. Many wives will run away the moment the husband loses a lucrative job. But this is not supposed to be so. When it is all right, we are together. When it is all wrong, we go through it together and pray together, and solution will come very speedily. And I pray your family, whatever might be happening now, I believe that a new day has come in Jesus' name. Remember that obedience to the word of God solves every problem. Truly, no family is completely immune to challenges. But the presence of Christ in the home, when we allow him to be the head of the home and the silent listener to every conversation, we'll be very careful in dealing with one another. And we overcome all those challenges. When there is love and consideration for one another in the family, our homes can still be a haven of righteousness. But it will still be a place of peace, joy, comfort, rest, respect, fellowship, where we pray together, where we sing together, where we laugh together, where we rejoice together, where we do things together. And in the fellowship, fruitfulness will come. Therefore, what the Bible now says in this 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22 is, saying that ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto a faint love of the brethren. See that ye love one another with a pure heart, how? Fervently. And the Lord will give you the grace to love your spouse fervently. And the Lord will give you the grace to love Jesus Christ with all your heart fervently. Remember that as a child in the kingdom of God, Jesus Christ is coming back as he is the husband of the church. How much do you love Jesus? How much do you respect Jesus? How much do you submit to the authority of Jesus? These are the things we consider this day. When you give Jesus Christ his rightful place in your heart, in your life, in what you do, you obey him in every instruction he gives, then when Jesus Christ will come back again, the husband of the church coming back to rapture the church, you'll be one of the bride that will go with him. May the Lord give you the grace to obey all this in Jesus' name. Remember that what we study today is about love of the husband to the wife, submission of the wife to the husband. And all of us together will remember that moderation, Christian sobriety, must characterize our life. We must be decent, we must be holy, we must not be shabby at the same time. Let us live as children of God. And when Jesus comes back and he sees a beautiful bride, a beautiful child of God, definitely, the day of the rapture will be a day of joy for you in Jesus' name. God bless you. Let's rise upon our feet as we pray together now. Let's pray together now. Thank you, Father, for the teaching you have given us. We pray, Lord, help us to be obedient to every word that you have taught us in Jesus' name. Lord, may no one argue with your word in his or her heart. May we, O Lord, fully and finally submit to the authority of Christ. Lord, homes where there are problems now, bring peace, bring joy, bring lasting solution. And let all the children in the family continually see Christ in the midst of their parents. All of us together, on the day the Lord will come, count us worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.